Amen. Hello, welcome to GDC. GDC stands for Global Dream Church. And I can see many faces, yeah, new today. Welcome, my name is Bethel. I'm really pleased to meet all of you. To introduce myself briefly, I moved to Sejong about 10 years ago. It was a newly built city at that time, nothing even E-Mart didn't exist here, just the apartment, government complex, and convenience store, that was all we had. And I moved from Seoul. I used to teach in high school for 7 years, and before coming here, I lived in America for 2 years. And while living here, I had another transition to Bangkok, lived there 2 years. And yeah, my life itself is a life of stranger, and I'm happy to meet all of you. If you feel like stranger, yeah, welcome. And that's me, so I have heart for strangers, and I know all of us are strangers, because our hometown is in heaven, right? So yeah, blessed to be here. It's my privilege to deliver a message today. We have Dream Church miracle expressions. It's nothing weird, it's just, saying thank you, bless you, love you, and all is well. We will overcome to God and to all of us to greet each other. So let's do it together. Thank you. 감사합니다. Bless you. 축복합니다. Love you. 사랑합니다. All is well. 잘 될 거예요. We will overcome. 승리하세요. Okay. The message I'm going to share with you today is to Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3 to 12. And the title is Partner with God. So let's watch the passage video and come back.
We ought always to thank God for you, brothers and sisters, and rightly so, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love all of you have for one another is increasing. Therefore, among God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and faith in all the persecutions and trials you are enduring. All this is evidence that God's judgment is right, and as a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. God is just. He will pay back trouble to those who trouble you and give relief to you who are troubled and to us as well. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. He will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might, on the day he comes to be glorified in his holy people and to be marveled at among all those who have believed. This includes you, because you believed our testimony to you. With this in mind, we constantly pray for you, that our God may make you worthy of his calling, and that by his power he may bring to fruition your every desire for goodness and your every deed prompted by faith. We pray this so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ.
My son attends a Taekwondo academy, and before holidays or training sessions, he's often given small tasks. So one day he came home and offered to help with the dishes, and well, although it's very sweet and I appreciate it, you know, in reality, when kids try to help, they often end up making more of a mess rather than actually helping. And as I watched my son, I reflected on myself and thought, am I possibly getting in God's way when I think I'm helping him? I wonder, how could I possibly help Almighty God Does he even need my help? The grace and love I've received are so vast. So it makes me question how I can serve God. And as I pondered this, I looked at today's scripture. So how can we help God? That's my question. And the first way I would like to share is, beware. We are supposed to be. That's the first way we can help God. And in today's text, verse 4, it says, therefore, among God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and faith in all the persecutions and trials you're enduring. So Paul says, he boasts about their perseverance and faith in the midst of persecutions and trials. The believers in Thessalonica endured through all the suffering they faced. And furthermore, in verse 3 it says, we owe it always to thank God for you, brothers and sisters, and rightly so, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love all of you have for one another is increasing. Do you believe this? This was a church rich in love, encouraging one another toward love and good deeds, even though life must have been difficult for them individually. They didn't grumble or complain about the hardships they faced. Instead, their faith grew and their love for one another increased. What a beautiful image. So we too face many difficulties in life. But when we read the Bible, we never see Jesus promising, I will make you sure, you know, you avoid all the suffering. I will get rid of your sufferings. He never mentions that. Instead, God promised that though the storms of life may shake you, he will stay with you. He will protect you, give you the strength to stand firm and overcome. That's the message of the Bible. So we cannot avoid suffering in this life. However, one thing is certain, no matter how bleak our reality may seem, it will not end in despair of defeat. If any of you are sitting in a place of discouragement, I encourage you to return to the place of faith with a glorious hope. The place we should be is a place of faith. Place of faith. Being where we are supposed to be helps us cooperate with God's work. So what does God want from us? He tells us, it's tough, I know, but stay in the place of faith. It's hard, but remain in the place of service. Do you feel lonely? Still, stay in the place of your calling. So brothers and sisters, where there is no faith, there's no miracle from God. Where there's no service, there's no blessing. God does not command us when we avoid or run from our calling. Even when the trials and hardships of life seem overwhelming, we must remain where we are supposed to be. The place for a believer is the place of service and perseverance. Only then can we remain like the Thessalonian church, the children who receive commendation. Well, sometimes while driving, I don't know how your driving is like, but I hear a beeping sound like at least two times every time. The lane departure warning alert. It warns to me like to stay in my lane. And if I ignore that sound and continue driving recklessly, it becomes extremely dangerous. In the same way, if we do not remain in our proper place, we risk causing a serious accident in our lives. So are you in the place you're supposed to be right now? Even though God wants to work for us, there are many times he cannot, because we're not where we're supposed to be. God's often searching for us, asking, where are you? what are you doing? When we leave the place of faith, patience, and love, make it difficult for God to work in our lives. In Psalms it says, blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers. The blessed person in verse 1 refers to someone who's in the place they're supposed to be. Moving to verse 3 to 4, it says, that person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. So the blessed person is like a tree planted by a stream of water, remaining in God's word and abiding in faith. And such a person is steadfast and bears fruit in due season. On the other hand, the wicked are like chaff blown by the wind. They're easily swayed by a single word, shifting their lives based on worldly wisdom or temptations. They flutter about, unsure of where to stand. God has prepared blessings for us, but often we're not in the place He wants us to be to receive them. We're nowhere to be found. So my prayer is that you will be where you are supposed to be, in the word and in the faith. So Colossians chapter 2, verse 6 to 7 says, so then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith, as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. So I pray that we would be deeply rooted in the Word of God that we have heard so many times, and remain where we are supposed to be. In doing so, we will allow God to work in our lives, and helping God in this way will become the purpose of our lives. So in Jesus' name, I bless you that this becomes your life and my life. Sometimes we can be walking well in our faith, and one word from someone can completely change our attitude. I see so many examples while ministering here, and even while just hosting a cell group. You know, just one member is sharing her life. Sometimes it is a praise for her, but that praise is something that hurts others. It's so irony. And like, as a cell group, you know, leader, I know both sides. And I can't help. And in church, I see so many things, so many similar things happening. And now I figured out what to do. I need to pray. So I started praying more for GDC so we will not be flattered, or we will not be shaken by one word from others. I hope that we would move beyond the kind of faith that, like chaff blown by the wind. Regardless of our circumstances, we must make spiritual choices that align with God's providence. Choices that bring Him joy and glory. These choices lead to eternal life. I bless you in the name of the Lord, that you will walk according to God's plan, as His precious children and heirs of His promise. So the Bible says, we have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end. do not be shaken, don't waver like chaff in the wind, wondering whether to do this or that based on what people say. Stand firm in faith according to God's word, and I believe that God will lead you to experience this wonderful, wonderful blessings. Life doesn't always go the way we want it to. I never wanted to come to Sejong. I didn't even know the city existed. No way. I just saw the picture and my husband said, well, there's a new city building and we need to move. And what am I listening? Well, that was my first impression. Life doesn't always go the way we want it to, but recognize God's providence. Trust in the plans he has for you. When you do, you will live by faith and walk in love. What God desires from you is not for you to do great things. It's actually but for you to be in the place of faith, living as a child of God. That's what he desires. So today the Apostle Paul speaks of living with an eschatological mindset. So when you stand before God, he will not measure you by how much you have accomplished. Instead, he will look at whether you stood firm in the place of faith, living as a true child of God. That is where God is interested. So don't be swayed by your circumstances or difficulties you face. As the passage reminds us, today stand in the place of faith, love, and calling, no matter the situation. Persevere and remain where you are supposed to be. And this is how we help God work in our lives and how we participate in his mission to save the world. And the second way we can help God is by doing the work we are called to do. Paul praises and commends the faith of the Thessalonian church, and then he says, and give relief to you who are troubled, and to us as well. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. He will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. When the Lord returns, those who do not know God and have not accepted the gospel will be condemned to hell. But our Lord desires that none should perish, but that all would come to salvation. That's what he wants. So in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, it says, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth? Well, actually, the Thessalonian believers were questioning, when will the Lord return? Will he really come? Is it wise or foolish to live by faith in the midst of such difficulties? To this, the Apostle Peter responds, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. He's being patient. The Lord is waiting. He's patient because he desires that more people come to salvation. For those who doubt this truth, God provides two types of revelation. And the first is special revelation. Through the Bible, God reveals his plan and heart. He sent Jesus Christ to fulfill his promises, becoming a living testimony. So theologically, this gospel is referred to as special revelation. Without believing God's word and truth of Christ's death and resurrection, no one can be saved. So it's only through Scripture and Jesus Christ that we come to know God's love and his plan for salvation. to supplement the special revelation, God has also given us general revelation, which is seen by the natural world and creation. So by observing nature and the universe, we realize that it's not a product of chance, but the handiwork of the Creator. And Romans chapter 1, verse 20 states, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse." People are without excuse. Through observing the natural world, it becomes evident that it could not have come into existence by chance. No matter how advanced science becomes, humans cannot even create a single particle out of nothing. So God desires that you and I become co-laborers in his work, partner of his work. And the most important work we can do is a work of saving souls. That's why in today's passage, Paul says, "With this in mind, we constantly pray for you that our God may make you worthy of his calling, and that by his power he may bring to fruition your every desire for goodness and your every deed prompted by faith." As I prepared this message, I was reminded of a scene from the movie Titanic. And I would like to show you the short film. Okay, let's watch it.
Ça suffit. Au revoir, Willy. Bonne chance.
Un de ces jours, mon vieux.
One survivor actually described the sinking ship as hell on earth. Amidst the panic, the musicians made a significant decision. They gave up their chance at survival to calm the people and help them escape in an orderly manner. From the moment the ship began sinking until 10 minutes before it fully submerged, these musicians played for over 3 hours. The survivors said that thanks to the music, people were able to regain their composure and evacuate the children and others calmly. Those who couldn't escape listened to the music as they prepared for their final moments. Although many of the characters in the movie are fictional, the band leader was a real person. His name was Wallace Hartley. He led the band, and in the face of death, he played hymns that pointed those in fear to the hope of heaven. According to survivors, Hartley continued playing to the very end, shouting, "Trust in Jesus Christ. He is our hope." He kept shouting. Afterward, a funeral was held in Hartley's hometown, attended by 40,000 people. A statue was even erected in his honor. The Titanic, once considered the pinnacle of human achievement and deemed unsinkable, was a stark reminder of human arrogance. So today, many still believe that with advancement in science and technology, we can secure our future indefinitely. Yet countless people take their own lives due to emptiness. And this world, which is sinking like the Titanic, we must share the living hope of Jesus Christ with those who love. So Daniel 12, verse 3, it says, those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Well, today I share two things with you. The first thing was the Lord is at work for the salvation of this world. And the ways we can help God in his mission are being in the place where we are called to be and doing the work we are called to do. So the passage concludes with this in verse 12. It says, we pray this so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that you would bring glory to God and that through you, he would be glorified as well. Let us pray.